myself. I'm seeking services. What can I do right now? That's kind of what this session is intended to inform you on. So similarly as before, we're going to do another mindfulness exercise. This is 4-7-8 breathing, in which case we will inhale through our nose for 4 counts, and then we'll hold our breath for 7 counts. And then we'll exhale via our mouth, making a whoosh sound for 8 counts. And then we'll repeat this process. So I will guide us through first with 4 counts in. Holding for 7 counts. And then exhaling with a whoosh. And then inhaling through the nose for 4. Holding for 7. And do it one more time through the nose, 4 counts. Hold for 7. And feel free to take some more deep breaths if you need them. I certainly do. And again, just another super simple exercise, just drawing awareness to the breath in a lot of different forms and can be useful for a lot of different things. And we're not going to go over this now, but a great paper from Dr. Rosalind Watts. She used to be the medical director for Synthesis Institute, and she also, probably more importantly, was the head of the psilocybin for depression trials at Imperial College London. There's a great documentary called Magic Medicine that's on, I think, on Amazon streaming or something with her and Cara Harris. And So Dr. Watts wrote a great paper. As someone who was sort of deeply immersed in the field some years ago, she saw some of the shortcomings of some of the ways that psychedelics were presented in media and some of the limitations of studies in science. The short version of this paper and why I recommend reading it, and again, it's included in the book that you guys will receive at the table, is that she speaks about like the dangers of promising like one session and done, the dangers of ignoring the fact that people, like, after they have an insight, they still need to have a functional life to return to or to integrate into. That just having an insight can be very helpful and very useful, but ultimately that, like, in order to really foster wellness, like, we need to heal, like, the collective wound in a lot of these instances. And in autism care, same thing. I've talked about it kind of quietly with other people, but, like, my intention, yes, psychedelic stuff will always be a part of it, but I've seen the value in potentially building, like, residential centers for autistic adults to not only have a place to receive care, but also a place and an outlet to give care, which could be also a therapeutic part of their just general day-to-day existence. Like, it might be commonly known, but for those who get habituated out of socialization, they, like, can lose touch with the fact that, like, giving and caring and showing up for others is, like, deeply therapeutic, just as much as these insightful moments or, like, you know, transcendent moments. And Dr. Watts talks about that, and her efforts in the UK orient around that, like, long-term, like, integration that never ends, like, people getting together regularly, always having new wounds, always having things to heal again. And kind of dispelling this idea that just because someone becomes clinically significant in their change doesn't mean that they're, like, permanently healed and that they're, like, good to go. They don't need to, they can stop introspecting on the spot at that point. Just kind of speaking to the nuance of it, basically. And some of, like, the backlash to the backlash of, like, did we create this myth and, like, an enthusiasm to make psychedelics, like, seem extra good? Did we, like, swing the other way and, like, promise miracles that might set up people for some sort of disappointment in the same process? So it's just a great piece. It's just, like, it's free. It's online on Medium. And, again, it will be linked in the book that you guys will receive. But it also is worth noting that there's a lot of psychedelic states, if we're taking the kind of classical definition of kind of revealing the mind to oneself, revealing the soul. There's lots of transcendent states that are accessible without without medication intervention. It's also worth noting at the same breath that some of these also carry contraindications. Holotropic breathwork, for example, has a contraindication for as well for like people with schizophrenia, bipolar tendencies, things like this. So there's always like medical screening for even, you know, deep meditative retreats. People can have really serious adverse events from. So it's just, you know, going in, being educated and informed, but remembering that if we're talking about psychedelic care for autistic people, we're also not always necessarily talking about drugs. Meditation and mindfulness, having, you know, the benefit of developing awareness, clarity and focus, and just generally providing, I look at it as like, if we take kind of Dr. Walker's definition of the autistic mind being sort of cacophonous, even in like relatively calm spaces, like really trying to cultivate stillness can be really, really helpful for this population. And getting comfortable with stillness and like feeling into the body can just have like a range of benefits for these individuals. Similarly, I touched on it, holotropic breathwork was developed by Stan Grof after LSD was deemed illegal. Stan Grof went on to develop holotropic breathwork as a practice. They're trying to further validate, you know, some of the, like, the neurochemical properties of the changes that are induced by holotropic breathwork. I'm not going to even touch it. Stan Grof's like an encyclopedia on this stuff. He's teaching like a 5-day workshop on like the beginnings of it. But it is out there, and if you're curious, there's a lot of like online free breathwork workshops you can like attend, or others can attend, like even just over Zoom, syncing to music, inducing some of these kind of like altered states, and like can some people kind of go down the path of like a sort of somatic release becomes possible through some of these practices as well. I can attest to like the few times I've done holotropic breathwork, it was more intense than like doing even high doses of LSD. I would like go into like a fetal position and just weep. And at times that was very challenging, and I needed support during those times as well. But these practices are out there. There's plenty of tracks if people are considering getting into somatics work or things, breath work as well. There's plenty of tracks, and there's plenty of potential for these things to be assistive, either in retreat settings or as just like kind of one-off workshop offerings. Something maybe less often talked about is sensory deprivation tanks, which I personally engage in quite often. It's somewhat luxurious to have even the chance to. They're usually just in urban areas. You can also purchase one for like $1,000, fill it with Epsom salt, and like float like a baby for a long time. It tends to just be like really gentle on the nervous system and just good for that like regulatory reset. John C. Lilly, who actually kind of invented the sensory deprivation tank, also did a lot of ketamine work with sensory deprivation tanks, which is like double dissociation. But to the same level, like they're also kind of exploring that as like a therapeutic adjunct for the fact that like you're just like fully relaxed and like fully like setting down your nervous system. If that, for a lot of people, that can be like an incredibly pleasant experience to have, and can allow them also to contextualize as they sort of like re-land in their body. They get this little bit of like incremental perspective on how they relate to their body as they come back from those types of experiences, which includes sensory deprivation tanks. Just, I say it often, like the same way that MDMA may be aware of like what it's like to be actually fully calm for once ever. It like informed the next time I was worried. I was like, but I remember being way far away from this worried. So there's gotta be somewhere in between I can try to find. And it gives you like a sort of a point of reference to try to reach back towards. And I think the same with sensory deprivation tanks, just regular exposure to that and knowing that that's coming can like make seemingly difficult to endure situations be a little bit more endurable, knowing that you have a point of relief that might be available to you on a regular basis. In adolescence, we often see people in like classrooms giving like, you know, weighted blankets to individuals, giving them like sensory breaks, things to kind of give their nervous system a reset. Sensory deprivation tanks, just one more. And for some people, it becomes more visionary because of the sort of way that there's like that decoupling between the body and mind. Yoga, somatic practices, fairly straightforward. I'm not going to go into too much detail there. But I will touch on this because I do think it's timely and relevant for now, just looking at legality and scheduling. Again, psilocybin, just theoretically older than like humans themselves, was synthesized by Hoffman, who also synthesized LSD. Has been illegal after the 60s when the Drug Act went into effect. Patchwork of legal access here in Colorado. We're about to launch our licensure program in 2025. There's also community care that's possible now. I participated in a program called Microdose Mondays where we educate people on microdosing and then give them mushrooms during that event. And the Colorado state law says we're allowed to receive remuneration for the education portion. We just can't sell them mushrooms. So they come to an event, we sell them education, then we give them mushrooms. And so that's possible now, today, we're doing it. And we're putting those people into community care. We're giving them like a text message group to support each other. And I think this is something you won't really hear as often talked about at the conference because there's not much money to be made at it at all. In fact, it's a threat to every other model. But it's not a threat to the people that are experiencing wellness together today. And I'm actually making a documentary called Here We Grow about that particular offering and how other states, because right now there's 23 other states that want to bring psilocybin programs in, but almost none of them have the allowances that Colorado has, except for California. That one has it baked in to their decrim program. But I think it's immensely important to point out that, like, we've now helped a few hundred people get access to a medicine they couldn't previously access, and it cost them a few dollars, and it cost us not much time. Question?
Oh, well, I would just like to get more information about that, because I was listening, but
yes.
I kind of am like...
That's okay.
Who is providing them? Like, is this how people are collaborating with, like, psychedelic churches, and they're providing the medicine?
That's sort of
another...
You're
providing the care?
So, churches can operate throughout the states in various... jurisdictions. There are people in church affiliations or protections that can operate. Some of them use that protection to operate like a sort of like gray market dispensary model. There's a place in Oakland called Zydor where you go in and you purchase a time card for the church or like a membership, and then you receive psilocybin. This all this stuff happens just as a sort of like oversight of like no one's sure how to police it. They don't police it, and in decrimmed areas, it's so low priority for law enforcement. They just kind of look the other way. It's not to say there's risk and they haven't been rated and that those individuals just have exorbitant amounts of legal funds that bail out themselves over and over. So you as an individual are still ultimately, even here in Colorado, even all of us running these microdosing workshops, at any point, someone from a federal level of governance could be like, we don't like what you're doing, we're taking your property, we're putting you in jail. Any of these things could happen to anyone. Same is the case for everyone that's selling cannabis down the block, though, at a legal dispensary. They could have their property seized and go to federal prison at any time. But the priorities are as such that it's not being enforced. Mm-hmm. But just bear in mind that, like, decriminalized is not being legal, essentially. But we're just doing it as a somewhat of an act of, like, civil disobedience, basically. Being like, hey, if we can get 10,000 people to sign off on this co-op that says, like, we were able to grow our own mushrooms for $10 a month, and they had infinite mushrooms, and they got better, and no one got injured. Maybe
so they're co-ops, like, that's what you're saying.
Essentially, it's like the early phase of trying to build those out. Because mushrooms are just so cheap. Like, one cheap mycologist can grow, like, thousands of people medicine, like, effortlessly in a 10x10 room.
Yeah.
And, like, there's you don't really need to make a marketplace if you don't want to.
Yeah.
People want to. So it's a tension point. Because the license program, to ensure the safety made possible through a licensed and regulated market, it basically thrives on license dues and fees. And there's people in Oregon already that are like, why would I get a license? No one's going to be able to afford this level of service. I can charge less and I can have more freedom. So they're bearing the risk of possible criminalization in exchange for the fact that, like, it's maybe just, like, the people they want to serve can't even access their services.
Mm-hmm.
And even though those high price tags in Oregon say, like, you know, $5,000 for a session, $15,000 for a weekend, it's not anyone other than the sheer complexity of how much nuance and, like, how much administrative oversight has to go in. It's like those people can't even expense, like, their business costs. Like, the stuff in Oregon's really complicated. It's not like people being like, I'm gonna make so much money off this. They're like, they're saying we're gonna charge $5,000 per session and we're not sure we're gonna make ends meet because it's so expensive, and they're bearing the federal risk of having their property seized, having their, you know, getting insurance for a federal Schedule I substance that you're practicing with. There's, like, so many layers. So that's kind of why we're taking this. I mean, by we, I don't mean, I'm not speaking as the autistic psychedelic community. I'm speaking as, like, local advocates that are pushing and just trying to help each other in practical ways. Again, this goes back to, like, I don't know, if I had venture capital backing or even a philanthropist, I probably couldn't talk like this or whatever. But, like, I think it's important to recognize that people are taking care of each other and they're bearing the risk together. And sure, there might be an adverse event, and there will be an adverse event in Oregon this year, just as there was in the doctor's office today, just as there was in someone that was using any variety of compounds. So we're just kind of hedging that. And the last thing I'll say on this soapbox comment is, like, I sat a lot in the OHA, like Oregon Health Authority, and I sat a lot in California for 519, which was, like, the decrim push. And there's always this concern of, like, if this is just out there, anyone's going to use it and they're going to get injured. And as though we, like, don't see that with, like, cigarettes or tobacco or alcohol, all these things that we tolerate.
Yeah.
And my thought is, someone who's, like, and this is just completely, this is not a lesson, this is just purely my bias being emergent, is that, like, there's this thought of, like, it's like if it's a trolley problem, and it's like, oh, if we flip the switch, like, everyone's going to have mushrooms, and all these people are going to, like, do all these adverse things and whatever. And my thinking is that, like, the erasure in that is that, like, if you don't flip that switch, there's all these people laying on the tracks that are suicidal, that are depressed, they can't go to work, they're useless to society right now, that we can lift them off the tracks in the process, and maybe we're trading some, and, like, But it's a matter of, like, we're more sensitive to the fact that it feels like if we open the door to, like, problems, it's our fault as governors or as people electing nice choices. But I think it ignores the real, not the real victims, but it ignores one cluster of victims, which is the people that just purely would never get access, whether it's because of financial or whatever it might be. So, you know, I don't know. But that's just me. And I just came through, like, the quote-unquote underground, which someone turned to me the other day, calling it community care and just disregarding the underground, like, some shame or stigma about people taking care of each other and just doing what they feel is right, regardless. It didn't have to be considered underground. And now with the decrim, we can actually just be like, we're doing this. And if people want to prosecute, they can, but it's come up before, and it hasn't really gone to the courts fully way.
Just real quick, you know, this doesn't address a federal at all, but I was in a talk that the governor of Colorado was talking to a group today, and the degree of support, both for the decrim and the secure access, safe access, it was unhesitating, it was enthusiastic.
Yeah.
You know, I can't imagine Colorado law enforcement going after people.
People have gotten arrested with pounds of psilocybin, like in conjunction with like a traffic stop, and then they're not prosecuted.
Yeah, and in fact, explicitly said, you know, the group that came up with the regulations considered should there be amounts of substance regulations, and they very deliberately realized no, there shouldn't be.
Yeah.
It's only intent.
Yep.
And so that's a beautiful, good direction.
Yeah, the law says the word necessary is the qualifier. So eventually, it probably will be a presidential case, and that's hence this idea of, like, we're making a co-op. So it's like, why are you transporting this semi-truck full of mushrooms? We're like, oh, it's for all 10,000 signatories of our co-op. And they're like, oh, okay. Like, it shows some demonstration of, like, intent and care. And it's also, again, emphasizing that that's not transacted. Like, that we're gifting all of that supply. And it might sound wild to gift that much, but like to a mycologist that knows, they're like used to just being like, I have so many mushrooms, I don't know what to do with these. They're so big. You know how to grow, it's like nothing. Like that's literally the model that we looked at. It was like a 12x12 room could have like an infinite harvest. In other words, like you're starting another and keep it going, and that could supply 1,000 people out of a 12x12 room like perpetually, and with like significant doses, not just like if it was microdosing, you're talking like 10,000 plus people for like a 12x12 room.
What was the term you mentioned you used instead of underground?
Oh, just like community care. It's just like what it feels like it is. I don't know. Because it feels like it's not opposed to law enforcement. It's like pro-people. I don't know. It's like pro-caring for each other. Because like the underground emphasizes this like seedy and like, it's like taboo. But it's not. Like what we're doing is just like, it's like if I like serve you like herbal tea, it's about as controversial as it seems to be now. At those dose ranges, like, you know, it's like if we had a rosemary, like, clipping party at my house, it'd be like, this is so benign, why is this even, like, I can't imagine the cop, like, the feds busting down the door to stop our rosemary clipping party. But I digress, we're getting too far from science. Does anyone have any further comments? Because we will go further into the same topic. There's slides dedicated to Prop 122 here. We'll go deeper on it, so I'm going to cut myself off. I get very excited about this. But I'm supposed to be in science mode. So, LSD, legality, it's, as I mentioned earlier, it's probably never going to be really legalized. It's being studied still, but most likely analogs will come through. MDMA, right now, and talk to the MAPS people, and talk to the whole conference, they're going to talk about this like infinity times. But basically, short version, next year, probably going to be available for PTSD, and probably going to be off-label prescribable for the physician's level of risk tolerance. Basically what it seems like, and they did make an insurance marking too for psilocybin and MDMA recently, so there's a probable chance that those will be for certain indications covered. Ketamine, as I mentioned earlier, is kind of complicated. It was synthesized in 1960, originally for anesthetic. Johnson & Johnson then revitalized it as a treatment for depression. Then there was concerns about abuse, and then it kind of like had another comeback where they made an enantiomer, basically like flipped the ketamine molecule so they could patent it. And then it was approved with oral antidepressants, that particular variety. So you might be familiar also with like intramuscular or, you know, or intravenous ketamine, both of which are oftentimes not considered insurance coverage because those are off-label usage. And there's also an emergent crop up of like kind of mail order, like ketamine at home kind of observation things. the same caveat of, like, I never want to, like, demonize any substance or use of anything in general, like, make use of it, make use of the evidence of it, but there is a lot of supporting evidence that, like, certain ketamine treatments are resulting in, like, new dependences that need to be kept in check, and that efficacy is generally elevated when in conjunction with therapy, as is the case for most compounds. None of these things just kind of work metabolically and you're good. Most often it takes some degree of guidance, especially if you're navigating like interpersonal or inner kind of like trauma-related type stuff. Ayahuasca as well, DMT is still Schedule 1. You'll find an exception with like religious exemptions. And as far as legal access, again, we talked about it, but decriminalizing just refers to reducing or eliminating the penalties. It does not mean that it's available to be sold or anything of that nature. There's a lot of cities around the country that have decriminalized. Colorado's one of the first states to like fully decrim across the whole state in the way that they did and make explicit mention. Like, the legislation here is awesome. If it existed ever, I'd be very pleased. But there's a lot of financial reasons to not make it happen, because like, if California does the same thing we did, there's a chance that they might just put Oregon under, as far as like no one's going to get licensed anymore, because you could just go to California and someone doesn't have to pay a license fee and they can do the same work. They bear some extra risk, but like the price difference of like a $500 service versus a $5,000 service might sway people to be like, I'll tolerate that risk. And there's also something to be said, again, I said I wouldn't soapbox very much, but there's something to be said about, in this quote-unquote underground or community care model, there's something to be said about having sat on so many health authority meetings about how do we standardize this care for something that's so not standardizable, that having that variability, and having, like, I still think, no matter where we go, no matter what we do, there's no substitute for, do you trust the person who told you to trust that person that's doing that thing? Because that's about, like, the best way that we'll probably ever have, and we have that in the form of oversight, but sometimes like other forms of, you know, whatever it might be, malpractice coverages or other things that we kind of like accept certain kinds of outcomes, whereas the vigilance of the quote underground or community care kind of ensures that like trust must be paramount in all those dynamics. And it's also why I speak a lot about community care as, you know, the burden of you and your friends or your family or your peers, and being able to not only be there in support for this sort of medicine work at like subtler levels, but also being there in follow-up to where like you're not creating like a new separation wound from like a deeply impactful therapeutic session with a therapist that you cannot follow up with very reasonably or affordably. It's nice to kind of have like the person who was there with you for that experience and like as a support partner be able to like check in with them again and again throughout your lifetime. Ask any couple that does like MDMA once every year or two how much it helps them to like stay in check with one another. It's tremendous. And I've had that. There's a joke in the MAPS trials where like they knew who got the MDMA because they would like 80 minutes into the session, the person receiving the MDMA would like turn to the therapist and be like, I'm like, how are you doing? You're like working really hard today, right? Like, how are you feeling? You're right. Like, you seem stressed. Like, are you tired? So you just get like super attuned or whatever, but like it could be very useful to get super attuned not to a stranger that you've known for a couple of pre-visits, but to like someone in your life. So that's why I really push for community care models, because that's how I've lived, that's how I've healed, that's how I stay in community. And I think it's immensely helpful to be in real world situations, especially for autistic people. It's like we're already so mentalizing, and if you sit in a therapist's office and you're like, I figured out why I'm not social, it's like, good, go be social though. Like, go out there, go do that, go be in that, and these can be kind of like social catalysts. You know, go to like a bee lounge of a rave, or like the smoke circle outside of a rave, and there's lots of autistic people like avoiding sensory intensity together in like a really soft space somewhere, and it's like really common. But we can develop like medically minded bee lounges for these people potentially, which is essentially like what, if you look at like a ketamine center of the future, it kind of already looks that way with like the lighting and like the everything. It's kind of set up to be, there's like a parallel between the intensity of like the autistic experience and like the expanded state experience are kind of parallel in some level. So like we're like canaries in the coal mine for like, could you trip here? It's like, could you be autistic here? I don't know. I'm not sure. It's coming. Oh man. All right, back to science. So as far as legalizing, again, there's rare instances, but we can and probably will see it. There's a good chance that psilocybin is going to have a rec market or a medical market, same as cannabis. But there's also this push of like, well, that might make it, you know, not ideal in certain ways. So diversity of option, all this stuff. But just bearing in mind that for the most part, except for right now ketamine, none of these other compounds we're talking about are legal in any capacity anywhere other than clinical use. Which is to point out that anyone that